Hello and welcome to another day with myself, Jamie of GEOSynths. And it only seems like yesterday I was doing this. Oh, it was. Yes, I did the GEOSynths show last night with myself and a few mates, Aaron Russell, Marshall Arnold, and Chris Cynthian. And it was a good show, actually. I really enjoyed it. Lots of synths to talk about and a few laughs along the way. So if you get a chance to watch that, then please do. So hopefully you're all okay. There's not many today, but I thought I'd... hello, Richard. How you doing? Yes, I'm fine. Thank you very much. So I'm just carrying on doing... because I'm doing patches anyway, so I thought I may as well do some streams with it. I'll probably change it now. I'm only going to do an hour. Excuse me. For the simple reason, you know, that they just go on a little bit too long and not everyone's into sitting down listening to me doing a patch from scratch for 2 hours. So, where did we get up to last week? Well, I did quite a few last week. All right, John, how are you doing? And Dino Brand. Yeah. So where was I? I did some on the... what do you call it? The... I can't remember it, the summit, and then started doing some on the Moog ONE, which is here. New view. But I did this, so pop myself up again in the corner, little old me. Hope you're all doing okay. I think for this hour, yeah, I'm going to be doing some sounds, but of course, if there's anything that you want to ask me, then by all means do, or highlight something, then... yeah, go for it. So there's jazz. We'll do. John? Mess around a little bit more with it, but yeah, John asked me to do a sound, so make a sound that was from the Farfisa organ, and in fact, let's see if I can find it. So you can hear there's a bit more to do on it, but right, where's my history? Oh, this is scary, showing my internet history. No, it's just blinking synths, that's all I look at. Streaming, I was trying to show you, I can't find it, actually. Can't find it. YouTube. Should be in my history there, I'd have thought. Anyway, hope you're all doing okay. It's Monday morning, and I don't know what it's like where you are, but it's absolutely glorious outside. So, but of course, we have to follow the guidelines and all that kind of thing. This is what John sent me, and it is this. Turn it down a bit. So I've done. Maybe a touch of the cutoff needs changing. But I'll put it on the mod wheel. After touch. So it's fairly close. No, it's all right, mate. You, no charge for it. I'll just send it to you. Because you did a super chat and all that for me. So and plus you're a Patreon. So no worries, mate. I'll send it to you later on, once I find my keyboard to name the patches. But yeah, there's a few extra things on there. So, Hafalumpa, working from home has its perks. I guess it does. It's no different for me, to be honest. Only that before it was in an office that I used to rent. And do you know, I'm so glad I managed to get it all out before the shutdown, otherwise, because it was a council run building as well. So, managed to get that out. Yeah, there's a little bit of tweaking to do on it, maybe, John, but it's pretty much there, really. So, yeah, no worries, I'll send it to you later. Anyway, so, no idea what I'm going to do next. I'm going to do init patch. Let me just save that sound with another... Use the keys here to actually type the name. So, just do something abstract so I don't overwrite it. Oh, looks like Russian. Oh, you can't see that. So there we go. Back to that page. Turn that on. Me in the corner. Yeah, lockdown here. Have not been out for over 2 weeks. Yeah, it's pretty bad, isn't it, really? Well, it's not bad, but, you know... We've just got to do it, apparently. So I know there's lots of conspiracies and all that nonsense around. I mean, people burn down like 5G towers. I mean, how nuts do you have to be? Anyway, that's the internet for you, isn't it? I'm old enough to remember before the internet, there wasn't that many loons around. But anyway, let's get on with some sound. So I don't know what I'm doing. I'm going to compare, save. Init patch. What should we do? Another view. Is that? If you want. All right, I'll do that then. Stick myself at the top if I can. Yeah. Yeah. That's the out of tune thing that I need to. Still sort out. So, last pad, the first pad that I did last week was, if I go back to it, I think it was this, we did this sound. Thank you, John, you didn't need to do that, mate. So that we did that. So we've got what we've got: pluck sound and electric piano. Let's go for an EP. Why not? Electric pianos, EPs, and things like bells and stuff like that. They have a very, very similar envelope shape, but. EPs, I do tend to do them a certain way. What's the white rack mount module? What? Oh, you mean this thing? Oh, that's just a Thunderbolt dock. In fact, I've got two of them. You can't see, I've got one going into the other. Because I use an iMac, it's like a 2017 iMac, and it's only got two Thunderbolt ports on it. So hopefully Apple will come out with a new one. Apple PC, whatever, I'm really not bothered, to be honest with you, as long as stuff works. And I like the screens on the iMac, that's why I go for them. No, the one lower. Oh, that thing. That is just my Focusrite VoiceMaster Pro. I think we have like used stores in the UK, I don't know wherever you're from, but cash converters, and I got it from there for about 45 quid. The rack ears were all bent round, but it's great. I use for this mic, it's going through, so I'm using that. And this one over here is a Leipzig S monosynth, and below that I've got a Cheetah MS6, but you can't see it. Yeah, it's a vocal channel, that's the thing. Anyway, right, so EP compare. What do we want to use for an EP? in terms of its sound. Well, let's have a listen to Oscillator 1, first of all. Probably only need to really use one filter, so I'm going to go through to the ladder, which is on the right. Bearing in mind, if we add any resonance, we're going to start to lose some low end, but there's ways to compensate for that with the other filter. So just one. It's fairly low at the moment in terms of volume, but it will come up later on when I fill out some of the headroom. So let's have a listen through this wave shape. So we start with a saw, but you can't, and if you use the angle, the wave angle, you can get it a little bit brighter. So you got a bit of a kind of wave shaping, if you like. The good thing is the mix between them. So you can go from a saw all the way round to a square. And you notice there's a bit like goes like an octave higher in the middle. But saw or square, you can make them out of anything, to be honest with you. So, just for simplicity reasons, we'll have a saw on oscillator 1. So let's get the envelope shape really first for that. Now, with EP, we don't need to have sustain, so let me just bring up the whole VCA. If I can't, I'm on the wrong one. I always tend to have it about, I don't know, probably about 70-80% on the oscillator volume, just in case I want to use a controller to bring it up a little bit more if I want. So, let's get the shape first of all. So we go to the amp envelope. And what you have on here, you can actually set the envelope to a lot of different curves, like linear, which is what it's on at the moment, or you could have it as exponential and so on. So you get curves on it. But for now, we'll just keep it sort of basic. Now, with an EP, I mean, it's a fairly soft sound. You would think to have it straight away, but sometimes you want to get rid of the click a bit. So I'm just going like 1 millisecond, couple of milliseconds. Now I suppose we could have it down this octave. I'm thinking sometimes I like to have, you know, where the octave just above the one where it goes to mush, like that. I sometimes like to have that there in the middle of the keyboard, so I just drop it an octave on the oscillator. Just allows you to get some really deep notes. So I'll do that for now. But then again, yeah, EP. Now, we'll put it back to where it was. I'm struggling to play at the moment because I've got dodgy nerve issues at the moment, but we'll do that. So shape, we want the sustain all the way down. Bring up the decay. And we're looking for that piano kind of decay. Now, it's set to exponential on here, so I'm going to... We've got logarithm as well. Let's get it in the middle, if we can. Linear. It's more natural if it is like a... exponential. So instead of the curve from your side, actually, if you can see, instead of the curve being straight down, so if you think of this as your attack, and then this is your decay coming down like a straight line, you'd have it like that. So it's like a slope. That's a bit more natural than what you'd normally have with like a piano. But a lot of synths don't have the ability to change that. It's just like linear. and then we have some release. And we may have to go back and change some of that release and so on, because I mean, that's as bright as that sawtooth. There's no filter. Once you slap a filter on it, it'll give the impression of that release being shorter, because it's just gone darker. So, do that. Lovely pitch thing. All right, so we've got that. Now, what about oscillator 2? Now, what I sometimes like to do, especially with electric pianos, is to use oscillator sync. And you know, we think of oscillator sync as that meow sort of sound, the sound of the 80s. You can actually just use it a little bit to change the tone, the attack tone. So we have a bit of a hard sync there. So that's without it. This is just two oscillators. In fact, I'll turn that off oscillator one. In fact, it's oscillator one we need. I'm going to put it on, maybe a triangle, and sync it. So now, oscillator 2 is synced to oscillator 1 in terms of its pitch, if you like. So when we turn up the frequency of oscillator 2, it'll stay in pitch, but we'll hear this tonal change. Or we can have it octave higher and have just some high overtones. So we get that tone up above. So maybe that might be a bit too loud, so we can just blend in that tone. And then what I do, that frequency of oscillator 2 that creates that kind of bell tone, I apply it to the mod wheel. So then you can bring the mod wheel at different stages and get different tones of your attack portion. Of course, you could always assign the third envelope to control the volume of oscillator 2. So instead of it ringing out like oscillator 1 is, hear it there, it's going do all the way across. You could assign the third envelope to just chop off the end of it. So you've just got the attack portion. A bit like using it like the old D50 days. So, it sounds a bit naff now, it's all as bright as it is, but we need these frequencies in there, these harmonics, for the filter to grab hold of. Now, I might need a little bit more body in there. So we're using oscillator 1 as the main, we're using oscillator 2 with hard sync for that bright top sound. And then we'll probably use oscillator 3 for a bit more body. Now, it's quite bright as it is. Think of it like, do you know how you do a track? And you got your bass, frequencies, you've got your low mids, your highs and all that, and you place different sounds in there. I think of it that way in terms of building the sound. So we've got mids, some lows, mids, but highs as well. So really the lows we could fill out. So there's no point really banging in another bright sound like a saw, but we could use something like a triangle. That's off. On. Well, that's the thing, fascinating stuff. I just use sync for Billy Curry. Oscillator sync can be used for a lot of things apart from, you know, the typical lead sound. You can use it in pads, oscillator sync. If you've got like a DM12 especially, it sounds great on that, DeepMind 12, using oscillator sync Frostulated 2 on there, but use it in a pad. It's amazing. So we've got that. We've got our three oscillators. We want to, if you think like an electric piano, it's hitting, you know, metal, you're not really going to get too much in terms of detuning like you would with, say, you know, an analog synth. So maybe we don't want to detune too much, if we do at all. As long as there's not too much phasing, which you will get when you get two frequencies in the same pitch range, frequency range. So we could try just detuning oscillator 3 a touch. Sorry, I'll get back over to the shop rather than seeing my mug. Because sometimes just detuning, you know, one oscillator to the other, it's a bit like, you know, playing hide and seek or peekaboo. You can, playing peekaboo, you can look out the way and see more clearly. You can hear the frequencies more defined. That was a terrible analogy, wasn't it? Peekaboo. So, there's a good starting point. Right, so we've got our oscillators, and of course we could change the sound up, you know, drastically, really, if we wanted to, by blending in the oscillators. So instead of having oscillator 1 being very forward, we can have the triangle more forward. I'm happy with that. Now, when it comes to the filter, peekaboo, Pikachu. All right, thank you, Pikachu. That's that weird-looking animal, isn't it? Cartoon thing. Anyway, so we've done nothing with the filter envelope, and generally, really, for when it comes to EPs, you kind of match what the amp is doing, really. So, cut off all the way down. Envelope amount all the way up. and then we're going to bring up the decay of the filter. And then some release. Sounding a little bit too, I'm going to put it, open up that, make sure I hit the right button, filter envelope, decay, I'm going to just raise that decay, because it's on exponential. More release. Okay. Gonna ring in a bit. So I also need to go down to into the filter section, the key tracking, and what the key tracking is going to do. Because right now, this sound is going through the filter. At the same amount. It's as bright at the top as it is at the bottom. What the filter tracking does is alter it, tilts it, so it'll go darker at the bottom and brighter at the top. So then when you do play it, you will get like a darker tone going there. So now we need to be using the maximum amount of filter envelope amount, and we're using the cutoff at zero. Essentially, so now we just need to dial it back. It's just my way of doing things. Not everyone does it this way, but it's just my thing. Mm-hmm. still hearing that sawtooth of oscillator one going through, so I might change the shape just a touch so it's not as bright. So instead of messing with the filter again, we just mess with the angle. Or the mix. Sounds all right. Now that will affect, of course, the hard sync as well. I think I might just knock it an octave down because I do prefer it like that. So it's and then we just back off the envelope amount again, just dial the sound in. Maybe a touch of And of course, we've got the oscillator sync on, so we can still mess around with the frequency to get that tone. And what we could do is assign the mod wheel to the frequency of oscillator 2. Do that, then just change the range of it. Mod wheel could be whatever percentage. So now, when I hit the key and bring up the mod wheel, we'll get a change of the tone. It's a bit much. In fact, it's still got the LFO on it. So I tend to, what I use is, I'll turn the mod wheel all the way up, find the tone that I like that's the maximum. And then you can go through the mod wheel then. Try an octave lower. You don't need a lot of release on it because you can fill that in with you can fill that in with effects. Yeah, it can sound a bit like FM-ish, FM tones, and that's what hard sync will give you. Now, one of the great things about this synth, I'm just going to dial the tone in just a bit more. Is that we've also got another filter. So what we could do is then just turn the mix all the way over to the left, turn the SVF filter on, and hear what those oscillators sound like with the 12 dB filter. So we can go to the low pass on that, make sure I've got that selected, envelope all the way up, cut off down. I need to change the tracking on that one. Need to add some velocity to the amp. And also the filter. envelope, so that way when it's a little bit softer, it will go a bit darker. But what we can do is mix the two together, two filters, or have it going through series, so it will go in from one into the other. You can also get other high like tones by changing the filter type. So we've got there, we can have, probably needs a touch more brightness. Yeah, it might be better. So it can resonate a bit through. So there's a bit of a start for the EP. LFOs for this, I'd probably, what I could do is probably use save new preset. What do you have? You tend to have either phaser going on it, which is an effect, or a chorus, again effect, or you use things like tremolo. So what we could do is set LFO, I don't know, one we're not using, LFO 4, destination, and for this we're going to go to the VCA. So we want a negative amount of it. So we've got that. Click done. Go into the mod section. LFO 4 is going to that, but it's a bit too quick for me. Now, of course, like a piano, usually, you know, real piano, acoustic, you can hear it on the left and it goes all the way to the right. Doesn't really work that way with electric pianos. But sometimes, and a little bit of stereo spread can actually, you can hear the notes individually. So I'm going to add a touch of that, but not too much. What have I done here? It can sound a bit annoying on its own, going a little bit left and right, but when you play a chord, I'm going to add a touch more to that decay. A bit slower on the LFO. Go to the LFO setting. Now it defaults at like a triangle, but you can add a variation which turns it more into a sine wave. But there's also a smoothing thing on there. And I've changed the note on. Now for me, I don't want that tremolo to go on all the time. So what I can do is have it get the right one, Jamie. Going via aftertouch. So I need to change the amount that it's already playing on the LFO 4, which was something like 40-odd% negative. And then go to the aftertouch setting and have that similar. Oh, done it the wrong way around. What am I doing wrong here? Something ain't working how I want it to. Still not right on that release. So save that for now, and then we can slap on some chorus. So it will be a bit jingly jangly, like a DX type piano. So stereo chorus, just to add a bit more. Dephased, what's that one like? It's a bit too much. A little dry chorus. It's a bit too quick. I've done some of my own on here somewhere. So then we can then go to a touch of reverb. Effect type, what can we do? Maybe an eventide black hole type of one. Take some of that high level off. Or we could go like a bonkers. I don't really want to use a shimmer on that. It'll be way too much. In fact, I think it's the plates or the halls that are the better ones. It's a bit more roomy. The effect settings of that. A bit of pre-delay on that because that's happening straight away. too much on that high. A bit darker. So there's a bit of a kind of EP, and let's go to some of the things that I say. I'm going to slap on something, maybe a pad underneath, because pads always sound good under EPs. Right. Yes, it's been answered about the shimmer. Yeah, add some eventides in there. Much prefer, you know, A1. That's fine on you. I've got an A1. I've made lots of patches on it. I made a bank of patches, which, of course, you know, if you're stuck at home at the moment, you can go to GEOSynths.com, and I've got 15% off at the moment, so, off everything. What else we got? What is Jamie's favourite type of pitch shift use on the Moog ONE? I don't know. Does it have pitch shift as a whole? I'm not sure if it does. Let's get onto layer two anyway. I don't really use pitch shift that much, apart from on the no, there's no pitch on here as such. No, of course you got the pitch shifting of the shimmer. Not sure if that's what you mean. Okay, okay, what we got else on here? Is the Moog ONE really worth all that quid? What makes this thing so special other than the filters? Well, for a start, it's VCOs. It's layers. So last week we made a two-layer sound, which was... So it can do lots of textures, and of course the whole scale of the synth itself, which is a massive thing, because when you go, you use make sounds on this and then you go to like a smaller synth, it's like, oh crap. So yeah, that's that. You know, there's lots of things, you don't have to buy it, simple as that. I got it because I saw an interview with someone from Moog saying how many they sold, and I thought, well, okay, if I can get an X amount of, because I've made one bag of patches for this, and Moog hired me to do a classics bank, so, you know, it's done me all right. Right, I do sound design for a living, so, you know, I'm going to, really. Right, what we got here? Hello from sunny Munich. Yeah, hello, Chancetti. It's very sunny here in Blackpool, England. As GEOSynths has stated in the past, not the synth wars, the effects wars. Wow, that does sound deliciously creamy. It's a very creamy synthesizer. It's like any synth, you know, you got to put the effort in, but it's the attention to detail, you know, being able to save your own effects presets. So once you've set up like maybe some complex modulation routines, you can save that as a preset and apply it to other things. There's lots of things, and even the variable different tones you can get from each of the oscillators. You can't really compare a synth if you're just looking at a spec sheet. It's like, oh, that's got two LFOs, that's got three, so the one with three must be better. It doesn't work that way, you know. I've done lots of synths, lots of sounds on, what, about 13, 14 different synthesizers. Things like the A1, it only has, like, one LFO. But it doesn't stop you making great sounds, so, you know, that's really, Don't look at its spec sheet. If you play, watch a video of a synth and you just listen to the sounds, you think, wow, that's great. Forget about it. If it speaks to you, then that's the synth for you. It's not like, you know, top trumped. As John says, the one will be around for years. You're not going to see these types of synthesizers pop up every single year. And I know there'll be, oh, wait till Behringer do one, but, you know, I think the prices of anything coming out of China now are going to be astronomical. When they're going to have to pay all their reparations, I think, allegedly. How is Moog ONE on the bass sounds? Yeah, it can do bass. But I think people, this is one thing I get quite a lot, actually. People get it wrong about, they'll listen to a polysynth and they'll go, oh, it doesn't sound as good as my Sub 37, or it doesn't sound as good as pluck any monosynth out of the hat. They are voiced differently. Because if you think about it, you've got something like, classic mini Moog. You know, you've got three oscillators, one voice. That voice, those oscillators have to really stand out. They've got to have the huge dynamic range of the lows and the highs. When it comes to a polysynth, if you stuck 16 voices of the mini Moog in a synth, it would be a mush if you played a chord. So the oscillators have to blend. Now, if you think about it on here, so say, for instance, I did three oscillators, and made a bass sound, but then I, you know, wanted it as a poly. I play a 5-note chord, say I've used all three layers, that could be like 45 oscillators all playing at the same time. So the voices have to blend. So you don't get massive low end on, they're just voiced very differently so that they will blend. But you can do bass. Yeah, I mean, the whole idea is the finding the right weapon for the right choice, you know, the right thing. For bass, get yourself a decent, good mono and for that type of thing, and you leave the poly to do what it's there for. But it doesn't mean to say it can't do bass. But anyway, let's get on with it. I have to reload this sound, actually. I think it's the chorus that's, might have to knock that down just a touch. Can hear it wobbling a bit too much there, so I'm going to knock the rate of it down. Maybe a whole note there, so it's not as intrusive. Right, okay, so we've got that. I'm going to go to synth 2. I'm just going to knock up a very quick warm pad. Maybe, actually, I might do... I'm going to turn off synth 1. Just knock off the effects for now. I'm going to do it as a square pad. Square A, but we're going to modulate the pulse width. So... sometimes you might hear the odd click from it. It's when you're going through 0 point. So we've got that. I'm going to assign LFO 4. Change the shot so you can see what bloody hell I'm doing. So LFO 4. And then I'm going to twiddle the knob, which is the pulse width. I'm going to bring down the LFO speed, right? In fact, I'm going to have it. You can go low, medium, or high, or there's a really slow one. I'm going to change the variation so it's more like a sine wave. Key to pads is movement. We've got that. I'm also going to bring up the synth spread of that, and then go up the synth level. I like the sound of that. We can also, if we wanted to, we could change the mix a bit more. So we're going from saw to square, but we've still got pulse width going on. So I'm going to reuse LFO4 to do exactly that. So you can do the shortcuts, but I actually prefer doing it this way in the actual mod matrix, because you can sometimes, when you're scrolling, go past something, you think, oh, what about that? So I want to go to oscillate 1, mix. So that's oscillator 1. I'm going to listen to oscillator 2 now. Let's listen for a tone, maybe something a bit triangular. Now you hear that just by moving that knob from triangle to it's like an inverted saw. It's a bit like, it already sounds like it's being filtered. But we're not using a filter. So you can use that to your advantage. So maybe I'm going to leave it like a, don't know if you can see on there. No, you can't. Can you see? Well, there, you can see it's like a sawtooth, but it's the other way. And it goes to a triangle. I'm going to use envelope 3 to do that. So I'm going to select destination, and then, what was it, the mix? That was the angle, wasn't it? So we do that. Done. Go into the... Yeah, so it's going to... Kind of like that sound of that a bit better. So we're using the envelope now to change the wave of this, the shape of it over time. It'll do it once, we can loop it, but I'm not a huge fan of looping envelopes because you have to more or less get them quite similar anyway, otherwise you get like sometimes get a click. We'll try it though. Loop it. He says and it works very well. Ah, oh, no, there's the clips. Sometimes that can be a bit too much, so I'm going to leave the loop off. So we've got that. That's oscillator 2. I'm going to bring that up, and now I'm going to bring on oscillator 1. Then we can detune the 2. Okay, so we've got that for our oscillators, 2 oscillators. Now, of course, going through that, you can hear the range of tones that you can get from just messing around with the oscillators. Now, check out my... I did do a video on oscillator blending, which goes into that a bit more detail. Because what we're trying to create is a wave shape, a final wave shape, to then go into the filter. we've got this subtle gurgling movement going on. Okay, down to the filter. What sort of filter can we use? Yeah, we'll stick with the ladder for now. Because once we add some resonance, it's going to duck some of the low end, which will, as we're adding this to that electric piano, it should, they won't conflict with each other. Envelope all the way up, envelope amount, should I say, cut off all the way down, resonance down, mix all over to the right, so that'll help with volume. and right, so what do we need? Pad, a touch of the attack taken off the front end for the amp. For me, the filter envelope is the most important out of any of them. Turn up the volume, pump up the volume for the amp, and then release. Now, of course, we've got the filter cutoff clamped all the way down, and we've got the envelope amount for the filter all the way up. But, of course, if it's not doing diddly squat because we haven't got a shape in yet for the filter envelope. So we can bring up the attack now. Now, if that's too much, then you just add a lot more. Now, depending on your synth, these are, you can change the curves of these, so... Okay, so we've got the attack, that's just the attack portion. Decay, I tend to have it like just a touch more actually, so it's a little slower. Include it a bit more. Okay, and then keep your keys pushed down, bring up sustain, find your level. Then release, and release is just like the cutoff. You're someone grabbing hold of the cutoff knob and turning it down. So that's creating a bloom, but actually what we're looking for is a warm pad. So of course what we've got, the envelope amount knob all the way up full, cut off all the way down. So all we need to do is back off the envelope amount, back that off, and it will get darker, but less of a bloom. So bring up the cutoff to dial it in. Maybe a touch more, because I'm thinking in mine now, that electric piano. It's a touch of bloom. Do we want it that much? Maybe not. The back off the envelope amount. See, now don't need to mess with the envelope knobs, the ADSR. Okay, nice warm pad. No effects on it yet. Might add a touch of, sorry, in the filter, bit of key tracking, so it gets a little bit darker at the lower end. But I don't want it to be too obtrusive, this sound. Okay, what can we do for... We've already got reverb for the master effect, so... I could add chorus. But with a bit of detune there and separation and stereo spread... It sounds like there's chorus on there anyway, because they're VCOs. And sometimes this synth just doesn't need effects. And it's one of the only ones that I've found that is like that. But what we can do, stereo chorus... what's slow motion? A bit too much, but we'll back it off. And we've got the reverbs. Okay, and then we can go into the... I know that's going to sound a bit too loud compared to the piano. Now we're going to bring on the piano. And I might kind of like the sound of 12dB filters. So luckily on here, like the sub-37, you've got different felt slopes, not just your regular 12 and 24. You got 18 and 6. So I'm going to try 18. Should let through a bit more mids and high mids. So now all I'm listening for now is to blend those two sounds together. The pad's a little bit too loud for me. To 12 dB and just then reduce the sound again. So, you know, it needs a bit more tweaking and things like that to help it blend a bit more. But as I said, we've already got on the electric piano, we've assigned the mod wheel to the oscillator sync. We'll need to turn off that on. Blah, blah, blah. It defaults with a LFO 1-2 pitch, so I'll have to turn that off. So I might even try doing like a modulated delay on there instead of using chorus for that pad, because delays are very good for filling in the gap between when you change chord, and it can give like a kind of false release sound. But yeah, just for now, just overwrite it. So, you know, there's another layer on here, so I could add something else over the top, maybe some high strings, and then use the XY pad to swap and crossfade between them. Lots of things you can do. Excuse me, my hands are just really not working anymore. I did my back in about 2 months ago, and somewhere like my neck, it's like a slip disc, and it's pushing on my spinal cord. So I've got, it's getting better, but it's still weird. But anyway, I think that'll do. Okay, so any sort of things that people want to say? I'll be carrying on these every day anyway, so I'll be doing... I'm not going to be doing bonkers sounds, like sound effects or anything like that, because I want to make sounds that people can play. It's kind of generic, but I've got to like them as well. At the minute, this is all right. It's not quite there for me yet, so I need to work on it a bit more. Right, what have I missed? Right, we're going all the way back. Oh, hello, Sonic Neutronic. Going back a little bit. Yeah, Synvisor's going back. I hear Dave is working on a new thing. Yeah, we've talked about that last night on the show. No idea what it'll be. Hopefully it's a nice big poly with more voices. Something like the Prophet 6 and the OB6 joined together. or, you know, he's saying his gift to the world, maybe he's redoing the Prophet 5, but don't know. What we got here? Todd Carpenter says, one trick I do is sub 37 mono in, then reamp to stereo and apply effects. Great way to rearrange your face. Great one, Todd. Yeah, that's a good idea. Da, 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 da. Richard says, he's really not sure about the Pro 3. It's incredible flexible, but I still haven't heard a demo that made me go, wow. Have a look at Thingy's stuff, Sonic Neutronic. He's done loads of videos with it. So check out him. It all depends, because, you know, you can say, oh, I've not heard anything I like. It depends on what you like. Types of sounds. You know, it's... I mean, the whole sort of Pro 2 and then the Pro 3, they're kind of Swiss Army knives of monosynths. I think that's how I see them. They're not just limited to a short range of, and of course, the sequencers are always great on there. You got to think, if you're just like a door, prefer doors, then maybe it's not for you. But then again, there it is. I mean, there's nothing really crap out at the moment, or for the past 5-6 years. There's nothing. It's all good stuff. You know, it's not a... this or that. If I buy that, then that means that one's rubbish. It's not like that anymore. Todd says, I want to get better at rain, wind and drones. It's hard to get a good randomness to it. I've done quite a lot of wind ones, and it's a mixture of a fair bit of LFOs, random ones, with slew parameter on it. So you don't get the like sample and hold, but none of the whoosh, 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 smooth that off. Apply that to filter. Also, at a different rate, apply LFO. LFO 1 to LFO 2, and LFO 2 is your sample and hold. So you can get different speeds of it going. So, yeah, it's all about that, really. I've got two now. Lucas says, great sound. Is it FM or sync? It's sync. Yeah. You could add FM on here, use some FM on here, but this is it's logarithmic. It's not a linear FM like DX style. So the pitch will change, but if you apply it to the sound that's synced, yeah, that's a good idea. We turn off the pad. Oscillator 2 is synced. So we can change the pitch of Oscillator 2, and we get... and it's changing that kind of metallic attack sound. So we could apply the FM to number 2, Oscillator 2. So we're applying the shape of Oscillator 1, which is a weirdy, weirdy, weirdy sound. Shape, if you can see on there. It's like a mixture between a saw and a square. And then we just bring up the FM. So that is going to apply to that. Oh, what have I done wrong here? Am I on the right one? Might be too basic. Yeah, you can't modulate a synced sound, so it won't allow it. Some do. Which, if you think about it, it's synced, so it's stuck. So it's not going to alter much. Anyway. Michael says, I bought a Novation Summit a month ago. Very pleased with this synthesizer. Do you plan to review Summit as you did with the others? Yeah, I may get round to it. I did Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday, I did sound design with those, so with the Summit, so you can have a look. Sonic Neutronic says, I'd really enjoy Prophet 6 sound design session during this lockdown. I might do. I mean, the only thing is with this, I've got the Summit and the Moog ONE, because they're the banks that I'm working on at the moment. So it means I have to move around a lot of stuff. But I might do. I might do. I'm going to be doing these every day where possible until we get out of this. We're allowed out. What else have we got? I love the OB6, but it's always fizzy. I love the OB6 is awesome. Before I got the Moog ONE, the OB6 was my favourite synth. Well, there might be an element of the Moog ONE's my favourite because the amount it cost me. But really, it's a pleasure to work with, to be honest with you. Well, in a sense, that's kind of what that sound I made the other day on here. It was it's kind of inspired by a drone. So it's just like, but there's the thing, I've got to think about sounds that people will play, and not everyone's going to be really into drones. So, while I make sounds that I like and I want to play, if I just did like 128 patches of like drones, then it's going to go for it, sadly. So, yeah, weird patches and things like that, that's not really my thing because I'm not into them myself personally. Anyway, what we got here? Synthpests, will you be offloading, selling any more gear now? Yeah, I will be, yeah. I've got, what have I got? Studio Sonic Sledge, the black one, that can go. A few monos, things like that. Yeah, I'll probably get... Paul, is it multi-timbral? Yeah, it's three-part multi-timbral. It's spread over the 16 voices, so yeah, it is. Anyway, this ain't more really about a review, so it's that, and I've got John's thing. No, I haven't. Well, that's the sound we've just done. Thought I'd written over it then. I need to do a bit more on that, but it just shows you the basics of the sound. And then there was... Oh, there it is. So, that's about it. I think that'll do me today because I don't want to keep going on for too long. But just waiting for it to kind of blow my ears off. All right, then. Okay. Why don't I then? So I made 128 patches for it with Singularity Volume 1. And then Moog hired me to do 50 patches. So I'm going to go to the library. Browse presets. No, I'm not. Settings, library. So, what can we do? Can we go to classics first of all? This is what Moog hired me to do, to make. Can't play that because my hands won't work. There's the presets. That's kind of like some stringer type thing. Thank you. that. Oh, the strings was a good one. What it is. Equinox pad. Things came on the one. Can't remember the other notes, how to play them. Guitar. So they're classic ones that I was asked to do. There's loads of them that I did. What's that one there? Can't remember how I did the lead either. And then it comes to my sounds that I made for my first bank. Right, if I can browse my presets. Actually, I think I did do put them in there, didn't I? So go to the bank. Is it that one? Peace. This one's got no effects whatsoever on it. Which this is the only synth that I've been able to get a good, nice, warm, chorusy type of sound without using any effects whatsoever. You can see there's none on. Right, cool. My classic one that I always do. There's just too many. I've done videos of playing every single patch, so you can go through to your heart's content, really. Sunrise, I think I'll go for a Schmidt. yeah, 20 grand. No worries, John. I'll send it to you later. He says, I let the sledge slide too. The sledge, I did some great sounds on that, especially when you use the MIDI commands to get to the notch filters and the PPG filters, which you can't get to on the front panel. Jamie wobbling his finger on the keys reminds me of the upcoming Osmos. Can't wait to get my hands. Yeah, it's a kind of, when I do it, it's not like I'm trying to be pretentious or anything, but when I'm moving to the right, I'm putting more pressure on. And then to the left, it really, so you get more. You get that. It's like you're using your hand as an LFO. It seems to, doing it left and right seems to be easier than trying to push up and down. So that's why I do it, and I think that's probably why most people do it. The woody strings was great. Well, that's the thing. It's an analog synth doing wood sounding thingies. The fizziness is because it's using the state variable filter, which it uses bandpass and notch. And I love those types of sounds. Very OB6-ish. It's the only price of the Moog One that keeps gas in check, because it's lovely sound. They really need to focus on finishing it, though. Do you know what? I mean, they've done quite a lot. When I spoke to them, I asked them, I said, I did a Skype, and I said, well, what was the idea behind the Moog One? And they said, well, obviously, you know, 30 years and all that kind of thing, but we just wanted to make the best polysynth we could, and then we looked at how much it cost after. And, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on there under the hood. And, yeah, there's still some things that need sorting, but I'm in no doubt that they'll get sorted. At least they can be, you know, that's the good thing. Right. I mean, end of the day, you know what I mean? I bought it because I'm a sound designer. Yeah, it's a big chunk of change. That's for sure. But, you know, I drive a 2006 piece of crap car. I don't drink. I don't go on holidays or anything like that. I don't party. Those days are long gone. So it's whatever you're into, isn't it, really? But it's, you know, it's my job. So that's the way I look at it. So yeah, that's a bit of the state variable filter, and I love those types of things. What was that? Can't remember. Anyway, that's enough of me. I've had enough now. Yeah, Wagyu. I mean, end of the day, if you look at my channel, I demoed all 128 sounds on it. And, you know, obviously don't just sit there and listen to that because it's boring, but, you know, have it on in the background or something while you're doing something else, surfing, and see if anything catches your ear. But that's the thing, you know, it's, you know, it might not be what you're into end of the day. There's lots of other synths around. Right. Okay, I think that's it. That's me. I've had enough for today. But I will be back tomorrow. And as I said, I've got 15% off all my synth patches at the moment. And it's already applied, so you don't have to do anything. So that's at geosynths.com. And yeah, I'll be back tomorrow just doing some more. So thank you very much for coming along. And I'll get my keyboard out, John, and name that patch, and I'll send it over to you. All right, then. Okay, thank you very much, guys. It's been good doing this. So also check out the show last night if you haven't seen it. It was a good laugh. I enjoyed it. All right, where the hell's my live streaming thing to turn it off? Yeah.